So thank you for the introduction, and thank you all for sticking around. Since I'm the last talk between you and the weekend, I'll try to keep this short. So this work was done with co-authors Vinod Vakantanath and Anantha Chandrakasan at MIT. And I'll be talking about Gazelle, which is a low-latency framework for secure neural network inference. All right. So what's the high-level motivation? We're trying to answer this question, where if two parties can somehow collaborate to perform some kind of machine learning task, but not reveal anything to the other party except the result to the party who owns the data. More concretely, we're in a setting where there's one party who has some inputs that he wants to classify, and then there is another party which has a model that it has trained from its private data. And the first party should learn nothing about the model except for the classification result on his particular input, and the server or should not learn anything about absolutely about the user's input. All this work will be in a semi-honest setting, which means both parties will follow the prescribed protocol, but while they're following the protocol, they will try to learn whatever they can about the other party's input. The main goal that we're trying to address here is what kind of concrete efficiency can we expect when we try to implement these kinds of systems. So there's some natural applications, for example, when the data itself is extremely private. So say if it's medical data that a hospital owns and it uses somehow to train a machine learning model to classify certain diseases, and then there's a patient who comes along and he wants a diagnosis on a specific image. So in this setting, we don't want to share the complete model with the patient because it might contain information about other patients, while at the same time, it would be nice if the user did not have to share his medical data when he's just requesting classification on a single input. Another potential use case would be if you want to just try out a model before you buy it. So say you have a small set of images that you are willing to test this model out on. So you can send them to somebody who claims to have a model for your particular task. And then you can send them these test images, and hopefully you'll get back the right results. And then if you're satisfied, you can pay him money and buy the model. Now, once you buy the model, what guarantees that it's still correct? In particular, if the person who you bought the model from was malicious, he could just either manually classify him because you are only willing to give a small test set, or he may even train the model after he sees your test images. Another application, interestingly, is the second talk from this session in particular, where they have this zero knowledge phase for within their system. So that is also potential application for this kind of a system. I've already given some kind of motivation for why we would want to do this work. I'll now compare it with what prior art exists, what are previous secure computation techniques. Then I'll talk a bit about the homomorphic encryption part, which is one of the core techniques that we use. The second is how we use homomorphic encryption to create these efficient linear algebra kernels for neural network computations. And finally, I'll conclude with some experimental results. So secure computation actually has been around for a long, long time. It's almost 30 years of a rich line of work that tells us how to do these kinds of things. In particular, if we look at these kind of interactive secure computation techniques, we notice that they typically use very lightweight cryptography. So as a result, symmetric encryption, for example, and as a result, they're computationally very efficient. The issue, however, is that the communication cost is very expensive. So in a natural setting, that when you want an image classified, you expect to send only the image to the server. Whereas in these kind of secure computation techniques, the amount of computation tends to be proportional to the size of the entire computation, which is much higher than the size of the image itself. So if you look at techniques from this decade, then the latest technique that we have for these kinds of tasks is fully homomorphic encryption, wherein you encrypt your image using a specialized encryption scheme that allows the server to continue to compute on it. And then as a result of doing these encrypted computations, what the server gets is an encrypted encryption of the output that he sends back to you, which you can decrypt. So communication-wise, this is nice because we are almost nearly in the original plain text setting that the communication is only proportional to the encrypted image. It is no longer proportional to the total amount of computation that we are doing. The other advantage is that in classic secure two-party computation techniques, you somehow need to represent the entire computation as a Boolean circuit, which is not very natural for these kinds of machine learning tasks because they're essentially linear algebra and not Boolean operations. I mean, you can always break them down to adders and multipliers, but that's really an inefficient way of doing things. So homomorphic encryption can often do these types of arithmetic operations natively. The disadvantage, however, is that the computation on the server side becomes much higher because these homomorphic encryption techniques are much more involved compared to simple AES or even traditional public key encryption schemes. In particular, what happens is that these encryption schemes involve some sort of noise, and this noise limits the amount of computation that can be done. And this limit, to get around this limit, you need to set the parameters of the scheme very generously, and that makes everything really slow. So before moving on to like how exactly we use these techniques, I think let's just have a quick recap of like how these networks work. I know you're seeing this for the fourth time now, but just bear with me. All right. So typically, these networks at a high level can be split into linear layers and non-linear layers. So these linear layers often are like these kind of fully connected layers or convolutional layers, which are just like some matrix vector kind of operations. And typically, if you look at certain reasonable problem sizes, like the MNIST tasks will have like some about 300,000 multiply and accumulate operations, and it proportionally increases for more complex tasks. So this is actually like where the bulk of the computational effort exists, in at least as far as inference tasks are concerned. The nonlinear layers tend to be much simpler, and in particular, when we look at image classification, nonlinearities that are used are the so-called ReLU nonlinearities, which essentially are like max of 0, x, which if you look in a Boolean perspective is just a single comparator. So the nonlinear layers typically are much less computation than the linear layers. So given that I've already shown you like two techniques that were used in the past, a natural question is like, is there any benefit to combining these multiple techniques? And a few previous works have looked at this and tried to address this. So what we show is that indeed there is benefit to combining these techniques, and in particular by choosing these parts very carefully and using the correct encryption schemes, this benefit can be amplified further. And I'll explain that in more detail as we get into the technical details. So at a high level, this is what we are going to do. We are going to take the linear layers of computation and map them to these packed, so-called packed additively homomorphic schemes. So these schemes are lattice-based schemes, and they tend to be very complicated when you do very fancy things with them. But our application of these schemes will be limited, and we'll just use the additive part of the scheme, which will make it very fast. And I'll show some experimental results to back that up. We'll take the nonlinear layers, which are essentially these comparison operations, so they're already Boolean in some sense, and we'll use traditional 2PC approaches. In particular, our work uses garbled circuits. All right. So it's obviously not enough to do one part securely and the other part securely if you don't patch them up securely as well, because if we can't keep the central part, the connection between them in plain text. And so to do this, we use this kind of secret sharing framework that has also been used in some work, some other works in the past, where the idea essentially is that at any So at any intermediate layer, we instead of having the intermediate results with a single party, we make secret shares of these results. So both parties have random numbers such that the sum of the random numbers is the correct intermediate value. And so this is the invariant that we preserve throughout our computation. So for example, if at the start of a linear layer we have these secret sharings, one party can encrypt it, send it to the other side. The other party can then take its random number, add it to this encrypted value, and then it will get a ciphertext of the intermediate result. Then it can do whatever computation, simple linear algebra computation it needs to do on this ciphertext and get another ciphertext, which is the output of the linear layer. Then he can re-randomize the ciphertext by adding a random number of his choosing that he knows and send this randomized ciphertext back. So when the first party decrypts it, he has a random number, the server has another random number, such that their sum is the result of the linear layer. Then once we come to the nonlinear layer with these secret shares, we can use a garbled circuit to combine these shares, do the nonlinearity, and then remake these shares inside the GC. And then we're back with the same invariant that we started out with, and we can rinse and repeat this process. All right. So I'll first give a rough comparison of how this approach works, and there will be detailed results at the end. If we were to use a 2PC alone to implement the entire network, then because of the large size of the computation, classify a single image, say an MNIST image, you would need about half a gigabyte. Which is like reasonably large. If you were to use homomorphic encryption alone, then firstly, the existing works cannot directly handle these ReLU nonlinearities, so they change the nonlinearities to these polynomial nonlinearities, and so you need to retrain the network. And secondly, it's very slow because of to get around noise issues. So. On the whole, like combining these two techniques, we can get very fast classification, maybe about 10 milliseconds per image, and the bandwidth required will be like about 10 megabytes per image. And finally, there is no retraining required. I'll just briefly walk through the ReLU gadget. So this is essentially what I said before. So the gadget, in addition to combining the ReLU, it needs to somehow recombine the secret share to get back the value, then operate, make the ReLU, do the ReLU computation, and then remake these shares. The key point to notice here is that all these operations are linear in the size of the inputs, whereas some of the linear algebra computations are not linear. So, for example, if you do a matrix vector multiplication, it's n square in the order of the vector. So, this is like asymptotically why this kind of approach gives the speed ups that we've seen. All right. So homomorphic encryption, at least the lattice-based schemes that we use, can be quite complex. I'm going to give a very simple abstraction to the schemes that we use, and we can work with this abstraction through the rest of the talk. So the abstraction is as follows. Imagine the scheme as encrypting vectors instead of encrypting single elements. So I'll call these vectors as like vectors of slots. Within each slot, there is some plaintext data and some noise that is added to keep the encryption schemes secure. This noise is very structured and added in a specific way to maintain security. The operations that we support on these encrypted vectors are the following operations. So you can add two of these encrypted vectors to each other. You can add an encrypted vector to a plaintext vector. You can also multiply an encrypted vector by a plaintext vector. And finally, you can permute the slots within these vectors in specific ways. typically the permutations that we do will be rotations of the slots.
Maybe we're back. Maybe not.
Sure.
All right. Maybe. Should I just disconnect and try again? Yeah, sure. All right. All right. Okay, maybe. All right, let's hope that things work. Oh, well, we're back. All right, so what I wanted to talk about was the optimizations that we did at the homomorphic encryption layer. So the thing that we noticed was that these encryption operations require a lot of modular arithmetic. The typical way to do this would be the div instruction, which is extremely slow. To do this, we select our primes in a specific fashion to make them reduction friendly, and then we can replace these div operations by add mul instructions. And this gives roughly a 7x speed up in some of the core arithmetic of the library. The second is like we have support for these fast permutations. So typically, if you just wanted rotations, you would use these so-called Bluestein transforms, which are Fourier transforms on with prime number elements. These are comparatively very slow compared to when you have to do Fourier transforms with power of two sizes. So using these specific parameters for the encryption scheme, we can get another about 8x speed up in the Fourier transform parts of the library. All right. So so here's some micro benchmarks on the library where if we look at a SIMD add, which is adding two 2048 element encrypted vectors, it takes about 5 microseconds. Similarly, we have some times for the scalar multiplication. You'll notice that the permutation operation is actually much, much slower than the add and the scalar multiplication operation. So the takeaway here is that don't use rotations. They're much slower. And so try to construct your linear algebra kernel such that they use as few rotations as possible. I just want to make a point that if we look at the per slot computation, then it adding to encrypted elements takes just 8 cycles. This is actually very fast and much faster than any of the like non-lattice-based techniques. So using lattice-based encryption here is key to getting a lot of the speed up. All right. Quickly explain how we built some of the linear algebra kernels. So suppose you have this matrix and you want to multiply it with a vector. One way to do this would be first you can multiply the vector by each of the rows, and then you can rotate these rows appropriately. So in particular, if you do two rotations or log n rotations, you will see that every slot will have the sum or like this the dot product answer. So this actually overall for the entire matrix vector product requires n log n multiplications. So there are better ways of reorganizing the computation. So there is this so-called diagonal approach where you multiply the vector that you have with the diagonals, and you can pick the diagonals appropriately and rotate the input such that when you sum them all up, you get the final packed sum. So the bottom line is that this requires just n rotations as opposed to the n log n rotations that we saw before, and this gives a lot of speed up. What this work does is that we notice quite critically that many of these fully connected layers correspond to very squat matrices. So they are not full square matrices, they are these rectangular matrices. And as a result, we can do this kind of hybrid technique where we combine both the diagonal approach and the naive approach in specific ways to give speed up. In the interest of time, I won't go into the exact details, but they're there in the paper. Again, for the convolutional layers, I'll briefly talk about how we implement like single input, single output convolutions. In practice, we need to do these multiple channel convolutions, but that I'll defer that to the paper as well. So for these single input, single output convolutions, what I'm trying to show here is how we do convolve a 3x3 image with a 3x3 filter. And essentially, the idea is that if you rotate the input, say, one to the right, one to the left, you'll get the left and right representations, which are essentially raster scan representations of the image. And when you rotate it by five elements, you'll get the top and bottom. So just using rotations of the input and then scalar multiplying with the appropriate filter coefficient and summing them up, you can generate the convolution output. In this case, you'll notice that there is some information leakage at the edges, so you do need to re-randomize those elements. The other thing is that you'll notice that like we need more slots than the number of pixels in the images. So you can also do this in a packed fashion, where we can critically exploit the fact that in the lattice-based schemes, we can multiply every slot in the ciphertext with a new scalar. And so by maintaining the same rotations as before, but not having any padding and zeroing out the appropriate entries in the plain text vector, you can also do this kind of packed convolution. So I showed you briefly like how we can adapt Gazelle to implement these kinds of linear algebra kernels that are key to much of the speed up. The second thing is that because we can patch these layers with regular nonlinear layers without changing the nonlinearity, we can use off-the-shelf models with a simple feed-forward transformation. In conclusion, Gazelle is roughly 20 to 30 times faster than the state-of-the-art techniques for implementing these kinds of tasks, and we can save maybe 10 to 100 times on bandwidth. And finally, I'd like to note that if you take away one thing from this talk, it should be that using both homomorphic encryption and two-party computation can lead to much faster applications. Yeah, and thank you for listening.
Let's thank the speaker. So if there are any questions, please step up to the microphone. I would like to ask you, can you clarify what is your threat model for this?
Sure. The threat model is this kind of honest but curious model where one party has access to some raw data and it trains a model that it wants to keep secret. The other party has its own data that it wants classified against this model. We don't want to leak any information about the data that is being classified. So in this work, what we guarantee is that we don't leak any information except the size of the image that is being classified. On the server side, we want to protect the model. And in our case, what we protect is all the parameters and the type of the layer. What we don't protect is the number of layers in the neural network and the size of the layers in terms of the number of neurons in each layer.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah. All right, thanks. Actually, I wanted to ask what kind of information you are leaking about the model. So you leak only the number of layers?
The number of layers and the size of each layer. Okay, in terms of like how many neurons are there in that layer. You can maybe reduce that leakage by like padding dummy neurons which don't do anything, but in our implementation and like the results are with leaking the number of neurons in the layer and the number of layers.
Yeah, so there are some model extraction attacks that have been proposed and that assume some hyperparameters about the neural network, especially this kind of number of layers and the size of the layer. So
yeah. So if you think of like model stealing in particular, then I think the only countermeasure that we have for now is limiting the number of queries. So like I only allow you to ask me for so many classifications. And yeah, if you can steal the model in spite of that, then like my intuitive thought would be you could train the model with your samples yourself. Like you don't get a lot more advantage from the network.
Thank you. Also, I wanted to ask if you have any limitation in the kind of activation function, or if you have any approximation of this this function, because I know that prior work has kind of these limitations.
We actually implement ReLU exactly because it's a very simple Boolean circuit. It's just compared with zero.
But for others? For others activation function?
In fact, ReLU is actually kind of like a bad case for us because we need to go to 2PC computation. If we go back to like these polynomial kind of non-linearities, we are even faster, and you'll see that in like the network results. There are like certain other non-linearities like the sigmoid non-linearity. I've seen some works which do polynomial fits to these, but we don't handle them natively. So we don't handle like the exponential function directly.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, I have a follow-up question on the thread model. So basically, you assume a black box model, but what if, so like in these transfer learning settings, so what if the client actually knows something about the network, right? Maybe everything except the final layer. Would that be a problem?
A client knows everything except the final layer. I would say that in this kind of setting, maybe like the number of examples that you need to transfer is fewer. So if this model that is being protected is being trained using this kind of setup, then maybe the bound on the number of queries that you'll allow will have to go down much further. But definitely these are like off the cuff remarks. Like detailed analysis is necessary to figure out like what bound you should set.
All right, let's thank the speaker once more.